Today, we'll be looking into the lore and backstory of Zhongli. There will be spoilers for the main and Zhongli story quests up until this point, so wait until you're up to date before starting this video if you don't want spoilers. So, let's get started. Zhongli, also known as Rex Lapis, Prime of the Adepti, Morax, and a number of other names, is the previous Archon of Geo, God of Contracts, and the ruler of the region of Liyue. In the ancient past, the lands of Liyue were besieged by monsters, and the people lived in fear each day. Though Rex Lapis desired no dominion over them, he could not stand by and watch as the people suffered. With pillars of stone as large as mountains, he rained down judgment upon the monsters that threatened his homeland. His might was such that even gods would tremble with fear at the mention of his name, or the phrase he often uttered when finishing his battles.
I will have order!
He would eventually bring peace to the land, slaying great gods and dragons as large as mountains, but it was not without a great many sacrifices, losing all but a handful of his friends to fulfill his contract and his promise that he would protect the people of Liyue. Part 1. Zhongli and Guizhong. Morax is the oldest of the seven Archons, and is said to be over 6,000 years old. Known as the Lord of Geo even before the Archon Wars, he was close with Guizhong, the Goddess of Dust, and they formed a city for their people in Guili Plains, named Guili Assembly, which was named after them, Gui from Guizhong and Li from Morax's former name, which is currently unknown, though it shares similar characters with his current name of Zhongli. The first time they met was in Dihuamaj among the glaze lilies. As he was taking a stroll, Morax met a young woman with billowing sleeves. She seemed to be solemn as she spoke of the fragile lives of her people and her understanding of their wanting to gain knowledge for fear of the unknown. Yet she was joyful when she presented him with a stone dumbbell as a token of their pledge to build a city together and protect their people. She said, "This is the mark of our pledge, and it is also my challenge to you. All my wisdom is hidden within this stone dumbbell. With your brawn and my brains, this city would surely become a great one." Though there was no formal contract between them, Morax would remain faithful to her wishes to protect the people of Liyue. Guizhong was kind-hearted and extremely wise. Her reach shrouded the skies for thousands of miles around, though she was not very powerful. And so, with Morax lending his strength to her wisdom and kindness, they ruled over the plains in harmony together, adored by their people. They even attracted the Adepti of Liyue to join them and work together to ensure their people lived happy and prosperous lives. She gave her people four commandments to live their lives by. They are, to unite in ambition is to be steadfast and immovable for all time. Wisdom is like water. It nourishes all those who receive it, and in it is a reflection of the truth. Fortify the bones, that movement be supple when the time comes. Virtue grows tall like a tree. Though there be shade, it will flourish forever. She taught them agriculture and an appreciation for learning, but she was particularly interested in mechanics, and is one of the architects of the Guizhong Ballista alongside Cloud Retainer. The Realm of Clouds was built by the Adepti to house the ancient and evil relics she collected for her research into mechanics, some of which are a collection of rune machines, both ruin guards and ruin hunters. During the Archon Wars, she was fatally wounded before Morax could find her amongst the glazed lilies once again. In the book Records of the Gallant, Volume 2, named Dust, it speaks of a young woman that would walk the shallows of Bushui River wearing long indigo robes and being associated with the smell and sight of glazed lilies. A hunter is said to have seen her brandishing a sword against several perilous shadows, and when he investigated later, all he could find was a pile of dust covered in blood. Though this could be another maiden that wears long robes and is associated with dust and glazed lilies, this seems to point towards the young woman being Guizhong, the The time of the story is unknown, but mentions the Ministry of Civil Affairs, so perhaps if this was after her death, it was her spirit manifesting somehow. If this was her, and her weapon of choice was a sword, it fits with the description of the primordial jade cutter, a sword created by Morax for a friend who loved peace that he did not have the chance to gift it to. Its description says, "In the passing of many long years, many become mortal foes who once made merry together, while those who betrayed one another, or fought to the death, would come to share a drink, their hatred dispelled. So it was with this precious sword, carved as it once was to be given as an expensive gift to a certain someone. The jade, too, was once cut for love of peace and luxury. When wine vessels are filled with blood, and when tender feelings are ripped asunder by cold ambition and reduced to dust on the wind, gifts ungiven and bonds unspoken will become sharp blades with which to cleave erstwhile friends." Which could hint towards Guizhong being killed by someone that they trusted and counted as a friend, Morax then using what would have been his gift to her to kill her murderer. Though the more tragic interpretation is that Guizhong became corrupted by the demonic powers, as it says in the quest Treasure Lost, Treasure Found, "And there they fought upon the Guili Plains, where black dust choked the heavens and a thousand rocks splintered." The black dust could be a representation of Guizhong's corruption, similar to what we see with Zhao suffering due to the negative karma accumulated from his battles. If this was the case, then Morax had to kill his closest friend with the gift he created for her. As she lay dying, her final smile was a lonely one. Even as her form dissolved into the finest dust, she said to him, "It seems that our journey together has come to an end. As for that stone dumbbell, forget about it, would you?" Only to then restate her challenge. "This is the mark of our pledge, and it is also my challenge to you. All my wisdom is hidden within this stone dumbbell. If you can unlock it..." But she passed away before she could finish that sentence. Many years had passed since that time, and he never was able to unlock that dumbbell, nor would he ever learn what might have followed that sentence. Over the years, the wild glazed lilies too dwindled till at last they were no more. After her death, the people of the land scattered due to the wars raging around them. The plains flooded as the once thriving settlements were abandoned, as the wars went on for hundreds of years. 3,700 years ago, Morax regathered the people and brought them south of Mount Qianhong to establish Liwei Harbor and keep his unspoken contract with his friend. This is seen in the description of the summit shape of sword. The ruler of Geo thus put forth his might and carved a long blade from a pure slab of golden core lapis. With a single slice, he cut a corner clean off a mountain, and upon it, he swore a most solemn oath to the people. Those scattered, he would gather, and those who broke the contract, he would punish. Those who had lost their loved ones, those robbed of their possessions, those deprived of justice, they would receive recompense. Perhaps this is but one of the many tales that shroud the ancient land of Liyue, but the solemn oath that Rex Lapis swore is nonetheless at work within it. To break a contract is to make an enemy of this land, where gods once ruled. And sooner or later, the mountain Rex Lapis cut will fall upon those who break contracts. A legend still circulates, saying that this weapon's true owner will one day return to walk among mortals. Then, this sword will once again gleam gold, and its light will cut through the greatest of the world's injustices, just as it did when Rex Lapis made his solemn oath before the people. Part 2. The Archon Wars. This was a time that the lands of Teyvat were a battleground. Many gods fought for control of their territories, and to take one of the seven seats offered to the victors by Celestia. Though some, who were more peaceful, chose to avoid this conflict, such as Khaenri'ah, the god of salt. But even she would become a victim of this war, killed by the king of her people due to her inaction. Morax fought relentlessly against those that would bring harm to his people, and defeated innumerable opponents, such as the Chi of Guyun, said to be an enormous dragon-like being that occupied what is now known as Qingse village. The battle they fought was said to be at a great height, and after being defeated, legends say that its body twisted into rock, its blood turned to water, and its scales became the terraced fields of the village. Rex Lapis then bound its spirit in the north, at the windswept ruin, thought to be Old Mondstadt, after its fall, its bones in the southeast, at the snow-capped peak, which lines up with Dragonspine Mountain. Its flesh incarcerated in the northwest of the Adepti's abode, likely the cavern behind the waterfall we find northwest of Qingse village, and its form was crushed in the southwest, near the city of Liyue. The orange stones that have formed around Bishui Plains and the blood-fed trees are said to have formed due to the qi's power seeping into the land, even after its death. Similar to what we see on Dragonspine, with the frost-bearing tree feeding from Joran's blood. After establishing Liyue Harbor, the god of the sea, Osile, said to be a great shadow, would attack the merchant ships, creating great whirlpools and vortexes to smash them up and be dragged into the depths. They also say that a divine island would emerge from the sea, rainbow-clad and fog-shrouded, that housed great treasures upon it. Though, with Osar's form being that of a water-like substance, this island was likely just a part of its body surfacing and being mistaken for an island due to its size, with the light refracting off its body to give a rainbow-like appearance. Morax, then known as Rex Lapis, would use his spear, later named the Vortex Vanquisher, to pierce the rainbow, pinning Osile in the center of the deep sea with mountain-sized stone lances, imprisoning it beneath what is now known as Guyan Stone Forest. We also see in the archaic Petra set that Morax would pluck the mountains and turn them into huge birds of prey with feathers as sharp as blades, piercing the clouds, flattening stone peaks, and raining down like comets into the heart of the sea and the monsters within, becoming the stone pillars that we see today. Rex Lapis would go on to create a geo-whale to protect the merchant ships from attack by any beasts that would attempt it after this. In the primordial jade spear description, a behemoth known as the Bakui would come to dominate the seas that even his geo-whale could not defeat. Though it seems to be another creature, this could be another account of Osile, as the two stories are very similar. The Bakui's waves were so enormous that it would wash away entire settlements on the shores. Rex Lapis then created a black kite by hand, with jade and stones. It took to the skies above the Bakui, and into the heart of the ocean it dove, sinking the behemoth into the depths, to stay there forever. Near the end of the wars, he would come across Zhao's master, the god of dreams, a cruel god that gained satisfaction from others' suffering. Seeing her malicious ways for himself, Rex Lapis quickly slew her and gave her bloodhound Alatus the name Zhao, recruiting him as a guardian yaksha of Liyue to protect the people from the hatred that seeped out from the defeated gods and created monsters. Though perhaps the creature that caused the most woe for Zhongli during the Archon Wars was not one you'd expect. In his story section, That Which Rises from the Sea, he is tasked with eradicating a number of tiny sea monsters with tentacles that would live on even after being cut off. After being tasked by the people of Liyue with wiping these foul-smelling creatures out, he discovered that his usual tactics of dropping a meteor or mountain-sized lance would not be effective when the creatures could hide in the tiny cracks and crevices in people's homes. And so he had to go from house to house with stone prisons to lock them away for good. This grueling campaign took a long time, and by the end of it, Zhongli could not stand any seafood presented to him due to the smell and sight of it reminding him of those creatures. Though if sliced and diced into oblivion, he doesn't seem to mind as much. Part 3. Azhdaha. Morax would create other creatures out of stone to assist him in the protection of Liyue, such as Azhdaha. While walking the lands of Liyue, Morax heard a sad voice come from beneath the earth, one of the geo-beings that were blind due to their time underground. He found the location of the voice, and came across a strange rock that housed the spirit. He brought the rock above ground, and carved it into the form of a massive dragon, granting him eyes so that he could finally see the world, and coming to an agreement to protect the people of Liyue, though Morax warned Azhdaha that if he were to ever disrupt the order that had been established, he would not hesitate to seal him away underground. They fought many battles together across the four corners of the world, and Azhdaha may have even known Guizhong before she was killed, as we see both Morax and Azhdaha mourning in a darkened scene featuring glazed lilies, Guizhong's favorite flower. After the wars had settled down, Morax's visits to Azhdaha became less frequent until erosion caused Azhdaha's memories to fade and forget the face of his friend. He lived peacefully for a long time within the chasm, but humans overexploited the resources of the mines there and destabilized the ley lines, causing great pain to Azhdaha. Due to this and his memories fading, he broke the agreement he had with Morax, and now viewed humans as enemies. Due to the destruction he caused, Morax, along with Mountain Shaper, Moon Carver, and a third unknown Adeptus, chose to intervene. They created a great cavern underneath Nantiamen, and Morax lured the dragon into it during a battle, ordering the Adepti to seal the entrance and trapping Azhdaha within. The great tree, known as the Dragon Queller, was a part of this seal, though Azhdaha would eventually merge with its roots in order to connect to the ley lines and draw power from them, biding its time before breaking free. Part 4. The End of the Archon Wars. The seven victors of these wars would meet in Liyue and dine together. Rex Lapis, crafting seven vessels out of jade and lovely stone for them to drink Osmanthus wine from, said to be the ambrosia of the gods. Barbatos would bring his own dandelion wine from Mondstadt to share too, though the rest have since perished, with only Barbatos and Rex Lapis now remaining of the original seven. Though Zhongli is still quite knowledgeable about the newer members of the Seven, during the Archon quest, Zhongli comments on the other Archons as they are represented in the kites we buy, and he seems to be quite understanding of them, likely due to the shared burden they all carry of being the enforcers of Celestia's rule. Part 5. Khaenri'ah. 500 years ago, Liyue Harbor was a well-established city, though the interactions they had with Khaenri'ah are unknown. Remember that Guizhong collected the rune machines that are said to originate from Khaenri'ah, and so Rex Lapis was likely aware of their existence. When we ask him about his involvement in its destruction in the later story quest, he states that he cannot comment on it, but that it was due to a contract he had made, likely with Celestia. The artifact set, Tenacity of the Millilith, shed some light on this time period in Liyue. It says, "In an age when solemn songs were sung from the clifftops, a meteorite once fell into the chasm. Out of the depths of the boundless night sky above, the iron meteorite plummeted into the ground, turning the earth to powdered glaze on impact. Though human life is fleeting, Rex Lapis personally ordered the Millilith to rush to the defense of the mines. As the abyss flooded forth, the Millilith escorted countless civilians to safety. Miners tell tales of a small number of troops from the rearguard who remained in the chasm. Together with a nameless Yaksha, they fought courageously until they too made the ultimate sacrifice among the jagged rocks. In time, the names of both mortals and Adepti alike were forgotten. In time, even the mountains and rivers changed form. Yet, there will never come a time for their honorable deeds to be forgotten. Like this gold-leafed flower, they will shine on forever. 500 years on, the harbor city remains as steadfastly peaceful today as the day the disaster was quelled. And still, the troops wear this golden flower with pride, in honor of the sacrifice made by their forebears." So it seems as though Gold and Rhinedaughter's creations were plaguing not just Mondstadt with Jorin, but Liyue too. This set brings up quite a few questions as to the source of the abyss. Though it is thought to be underground, perhaps it is referring to the abyss of space that the star-devouring darkness comes from. The event in the chasm seems to have been caused in some way by Khaenri'ah, as it was at the time of its destruction, and so Rex Lapis taking part in their destruction may have been a necessary evil to protect his people from the abyss spreading further. One strange thing to me is the fact that the travelers came to Teyvat in meteorites too, but that's a topic for another video. Part 6. Rex Incognito. As the wars faded and peace slowly came to Liyue, Rex Lapis would incarnate in different forms to interact with his people, as shown in the book Rex Incognito. Though the timeline for the stories is hard to decipher, as one story leads into another, which leads into another, they revolve around a jade plaque. Rex Lapis appears in an antique store in the guise of a young nobleman, and tells the owner, Mingui, that the jade plaque she has spent the better part of her fortune to acquire is a fake. She is aggravated by his bluntness and asks why he would think that, to which he replies, "The image carved onto this jade is that of a woman." This is a highly unusual thing to see among similar relics from the era in question. Although there are plenty of rumors to this effect, the claim that Rex Lapis once took the form of a woman is not attested to by any of the historical records, and there is no physical evidence of it ever occurring. To which she replies by telling him a story about a jade plaque created by a jade craftsman that was said to be incorrigibly irreverent and loved to jest. When a customer would request the statue of a hunter dominating a ferocious beast, they would receive a miniature statue of a distressed boar running for its life. When the customer demanded an explanation, he would tell them, "When a formidable hunter closes in on a fierce beast, he may not show his face, but his imposing presence is enough to frighten the beast to its core." And so his works became popular with the wealthy merchants of Liyue Harbor, placing orders with him to experience for themselves what it was like to be on the receiving end of this mischievous man's antics. Hearing of this, Rex Lapis appeared to the man one night in the form of a woman, dressed in a long, slender black gown and with eyes that shone with a brilliant amber in the crescent moonlight. They spoke for a long time and quickly found themselves in deep conversation. The craftsman, feeling that there was something out of the ordinary about her, finally, she said, "I would like for you to make me a jade plaque bearing the likeness of the Lord of Geo on its surface." The woman finally stated her request once their broad-reaching and lengthy conversation had reached its end, and she was all but ready to leave. "But I have one condition. You may not conjure up our Lord's likeness from your imagination. You must carve the true likeness of our Lord, relying on what you have seen with your own two eyes. Otherwise," she said, "I'm not paying a single mora." When the crescent moon once again appeared in the skies, she returned. The craftsman handed over a jade plaque in the likeness of their god, in female form. She frowned and demanded an explanation. The craftsman said that after contemplating Rex Lapis for 3 days, he covered his eyes and went to work on the plaque, stopping when he felt like it was time to stop, though he admits that even he was not sure why it came out like this. He appears again in the form of a young man from Qingxi village, employed by a notoriously harsh fisherman upon his ship. He annoyed his captain by refusing to go near any of the slimy or tentacled sea creatures, stating that he shouldn't have to do what he dislikes the most. This earned him a slap on the head and being told that he'd get nowhere in the world if he wouldn't do a job that he doesn't like. To this, the boy told the captain a story and had him listening so intently that he didn't notice the money he had docked from his workers being pilfered from his pockets. After discussing these tales in the antique shop, he surprised the owner by stating, "A fine story, I'll take this fake then." The noble son nodded, his golden eyes smiling. "After all that, you still think this is a fake?" Mingui sighed lightly. "Of course." The young noble could not help but smile, and indeed had never seemed happier since entering the shop. "After all, the story you told me about jade plaques being ancient currency, it's nonsense. Nonsense that I made up." Part 7. The Modern Era. Every year at the Rite of Descension, Rex Lapis graces the land with his prophecy, giving guidance on the economic path Liyue should follow in the coming year. He now walks the lands as the mortal Zhongli, with few knowing his true identity, and works for the Wangsheng Funeral Parlor under Director Hu Tao, their relationship being quite close, though he finds her pranks to be quite disruptive due to his more relaxed nature. He also assists others with ancient studies as a consultant and is well respected by the people for his vast knowledge and expertise, though some dismiss his matter-of-fact attitude about events of the past as being made up due to a lack of evidence. As he was walking the docks of Liyue Harbor one drizzly day, he overhears a worker say something that resonates with him deeply and sets the stage for Osal's resurrection, threatening Liyue Harbor and its subsequent defeat.
"One drizzly day, as I was strolling along the harbor, I heard a merchant tell one of his workers, "You finished your duties. Go ahead and call it a day." I stood motionless among the crowds, asking myself, "Have I already finished my duties?"
Oh, Zhongli!
But as I began to consider relinquishing my divine role, I soon discovered that many reasons still remained to not hastily depart. Was Liyue, the city I had dwelt in for so long, already prepared to enter its next age? I decided that a test was needed in order to reveal the answer. So I feigned my own death and gathered the cast of Child, the Adepti, and the Liyue Qixing to play their roles together on the stage that was Liyue.
After this, we go on an expedition with him to uncover the story of Khaenri'ah. At the end of this, he states that he wishes for the traveler to remember the story of Liyue, for even the rock that he had carved would eventually crumble with time. And he knows about the traveler being much older than they seem, and having visited many other worlds before, though we don't get to see this interaction in game. We next see him as Azhdaha is breaking free from its imprisonment. Though Azhdaha's soul is split in half between positive and negative, and the kinder half helps us with Zhongli to reseal Azhdaha and keep Liyue safe from his destruction. So, what's next for Zhongli? Probably more pranks from Hu Tao and forgetting he has no mora as usual. Though the chasm is coming in a future update, and from what we've seen of it in the heart of the Millilith set, it is likely infested with the Abyss. An unknown Yaksha and countless Millilith gave their lives to prevent its spread 500 years ago, due to Morax realizing the threat it presented and sending them there as the meteorite landed. If the Abyss is resurging in the chasm again, it seems to me that Zhongli will be one of the first to investigate it. But for now, we'll have to wait and see. And that's the end of the video. If you've made it this far, thank you very much for watching. This has been my longest video yet. The amount of lore behind Zhongli is monumental. So although I've covered everything I can think of about his backstory, I could have missed a thing or two. I've saved a lot of speculation out of this video, as it's already very long, and it'd probably be more fun to discuss in the comments anyway. So let me know if you've got any good theories or ideas about him. About the pronunciations, I looked up a video I'll link in the description to help me out with this, but I probably still got a few things wrong, so if I did, apologies for that. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, consider leaving me a like to let me know. If you want more lore videos like this, subscribing is always appreciated, and the bell icon will let you know when the next video is up. Good luck on your wishes, and I hope you have a great day.